The Pennsylvania German Hour is underwritten by the Pennsylvanische Deutschversammlung von Baddecks County, the state's largest annual Pennsylvania Dutch language gathering, traditionally held the first Monday after Easter in the Leesport Auction Hall. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the Westburgsversammlung, held annually on the first Saturday in October. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the Rentschler-Leib family and Reverend Richard Miller and family. The Pennsylvania German Hour is a production of the Nye-Dolbehock Sanger Corps, the regional Pennsylvania German choir specializing in traditional and contemporary dialect music for the heritage language community. The Pennsylvania German Hour is produced in cooperation with the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, the hub of Pennsylvania Dutch language and culture. Contact us at 610-683-1589 or visit us online at www.kutztown.edu/pgchc. Mir zauwe Grossdank zu alle unser Gucke, Unterstütze und Freund. Gute Maria, liebe Gucke, und willkommen zum Pennsylvanische Deutschstund, der Beschblatt für Deutschzuhörer auf BCTV. Heute ist der 4. März 2022 und die Jahreszeit von der Faste ist da. Am Dienstag war Fastnacht und hoffentlich alle ihr einen guten Fastnachtkuchen essen kriegt, weil gestern war erster Mittwoch und die Zeit von Faste fängt an. Hast du etwas aufgegeben für Faste? De Maria, habe ich etwas Neues für euch. Im Geist von der Segner von Faste habe ich ein kleine Präsentation über die Haus- und Scheier-Segner-Eischrifte, do in Sudosch Pensifoni und weiter. Today, I would like to share a small presentation that I provided in 2020 for the Cornwall Iron Furnace Associates, entitled House Blessing Stones, a Pennsylvania Dutch Tradition of Establishment. For those of you who are unaware of the Cornwall Iron Furnace, it is a museum and historic site featuring America's most complete charcoal-fueled iron-making complex that's located in Cornwall, Lebanon County, and is part of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania's Historic and Museum Commission. They feature not only tours, events, and educational programs, but also a thriving online lecture series that attracts viewers from across the country. If you enjoy the following presentation, check out other features from their lecture series on youtube.com.
Well, without further ado, I want to introduce our presentation for tonight on House Blessing Stones, a Pennsylvania Dutch tradition of establishment. Now, this evening, of course, I'm going to be focusing on those stones that are within the Pennsylvania Dutch or Pennsylvania German culture, but these particular traditions that you're going to find with inscriptions on architectural circumstances throughout Pennsylvania and throughout the United States, and of course, throughout the world, are something that are common to humanity. This is not something that you're going to find exclusively in Pennsylvania, but what we have here in Pennsylvania, of course, is flavored by the local culture and, of course, the use of the German language historically in this region. For this reason and a variety of other reasons, you'll find that these stones that are found especially on houses and barns and churches are often puzzling to folks who find them, who want to understand them, who want to find ways to interpret them and understand their meaning. And my hope is this evening you're going to be acquainted with a wide variety of different examples of German and English language material that is found in our local communities, especially with an emphasis on Lebanon this evening. And my hope is that you'll have a better idea of how to approach these stones and interpret them when you see them in the local communities. Now, of course, when we take a look at the local stones that are found on houses and barns and churches, it's important to recognize that these stones do not exist in a vacuum. They, of course, are architectural in nature, but they have many correspondences to other forms of tradition among the Pennsylvania Dutch, including inscribed items that were found in the home, such as blanket chests, like the one seen below from 1800 from Lancaster County, birth and baptismal certificates that would have recorded the vital details of an individual at the time of their birth and their baptism, and many, many other objects in the home would have held some form of significance due to the fact that they were inscribed with names and dates. Now, we can see that part of the significance for this is due to the fact that these objects many times are representative of transitions that take place in life. One blesses a house or dedicates a house by placing a stone on the house at the time that it is built. Of course, you'll also find that at the time that a child is born, a certificate might be made, or a certificate might be made to commemorate a birth of a child after the child has been born, sometimes years after. The same thing holds true as well with decorated blanket chests that were typically given as gifts to individuals of marrying age, and many times they will have elaborate inscriptions on the fronts of those chests identifying the individual to whom they've been given. The significance is not just in the words that are on these objects, but the ways in which these objects are emblematic of relationships and the way in which people lived and the way in which people, of course, interacted with one another. All of these objects are related in that way, and house blessing stones are no different. Of course, there are also correspondences with the creation of stone objects in Pennsylvania across a wide variety of trades, especially gravestones. You're going to find German language and English language gravestones all throughout Pennsylvania. And these individuals who were carving the date and house blessing stones are the very same individuals that were also producing gravestones and many times other utilitarian objects. These folks were going to be carving out stone water troughs. They were going to be making stone enclosures, stone walls, stone houses, stone barns, and especially you're going to find ways of being able to identify correspondences between the stone carvers by means of their carving style, the iconography that they're going to be using, and the way in which they did their lettering. And I'm going to be showing some examples this evening that I have been able to identify who the carver was. Many times these things are disembodied. Not all stonemasons signed their work historically, and so you're going to find a lot of tombstones that are unsigned. You'll find a handful that are signed, a fair number that are signed. You'll occasionally also find buildings that bear the name of the builder, but the name of the builder may not actually be the name of the person who carved the stone. You're also going to find that, of course, not all of these house blessings are truly stone. Some of them are in plaster, some of them are in wood and other formats as well. So it's very important to note that, of course, this is going to not just overlap with the stone building trades and stone carving, but also many of the other trades here in Pennsylvania as well. And when I talk about architectural blessings, I'm really talking about a wide range of expressions that you're going to find on wooden plaques. You're going to find examples of plaster. You're going to find many different ways that these types of emblems are placed on homes, typically with dates and names, as well as meaningful inscriptions and illustrations. And for example, you can see examples up here that use floral and celestial imagery. You're going to find ones that make use especially of stylized German script, as well as Latin script, but especially dates and names. This is such an important thing because for especially Pennsylvania Dutch people, when you consider their spirituality, when you consider the way in which they express themselves, oftentimes there is a sensitivity to time. This is visible in religious expression. This is visible in the building trades, in terms of the inscriptions, in tombstones, and many other different aspects of the culture, that there's a sensitivity to the notion that time is the measure of a person's life. And this is something I'm going to come back to over and over throughout the presentation this evening. You're also going to find that blessing of homes is not just in physical reminders in terms of stones or plaques. You're going to find a wide range of printed and written house blessing documents. Many times these are documents that were either produced by hand or produced by local printers that have lofty religious inscriptions in them, aiming to ask for inspiration from the divine, as well as many times protection. And these are two themes that you're going to see quite often in the traditions of architectural blessings, both here in the United States as well as in Europe, where these traditions originally came from. I also want to briefly mention that these types of formal traditions that we're finding on houses and barns and churches with blessing inscriptions, these types of inscriptions are not the only ways that people blessed structures. Many times there were other domestic and folk religious rituals that were performed in the home. The concealment of a Good Friday egg in the attic, the use of particular written religious inscriptions, the scattering of ashes with a coal shovel on Ash Wednesday around the home, the use use of palm crosses made in church, all of these things were done in the home as essentially ways of being able to protect the home. This was such an important idea to many folks in the past that they believed that the home was the center of all life, both spiritually and physically, and it required both physical and spiritual protection. A good example of this is folks used to keep the broom by the front door. The belief was that if the broom was leaning against the door frame of the front door, no one who wished you ill would walk into the home. These are examples of folklore, but they are part of the ritual traditions of the Pennsylvania Dutch. I will suggest that the blessings that you find on houses and barns and churches are part of a social ritual. They may not be in this particular caliber of ritual as we see on the screen right now, but they are ritual nonetheless in the sense that these are human behaviors that are timed, that are expressed in a very systematic way, and especially important to the passages of life and the transitions of life. Here's an example of one of these documents I just briefly want to mention, these written house blessings. And the reason I mention this is because so many of the texts that you find on the outside of houses are truncated versions of what you're going to find essentially in the traditional written house blessings. Here's an example of one by Johann Conrad Gilbert. He was a schoolmaster and church warden at Red Church in Brunswick Township, Schuylkill County. And here is his beautiful Christian house blessing, which begins, Jesu wohn in meinem Haus, weiche nimmer mehr daraus. And it goes on to ask Christ to dwell in the home and to never go away. The interior and the exterior is referred to in the symbolism of these types of inscriptions, and they are often lofty and rhyming and religious. And this is such an important thing to recognize because the information that you see in these is oftentimes corresponding to what you find in the architectural blessings. In addition, at the very bottom of this blessing, you'll also see it was specifically made for a couple, Adam Schmidt and his wife in Topahakan Township on February 3rd, 1784, and it specifically says, Zum Segen jedermann, die es hören und lesen. For the blessing of anyone who might hear this or read this. These types of blessings were sometimes kept either on the wall in the home or tucked inside the family Bible to be read aloud at special occasions. So we can see the way in which these poetic blessings are often part of rituals in the home, as well as architectural rituals on the outsides of the house. Now, when the site administrator, Michael Emery, asked me to give this talk, he pointed out an example of a house nearby, near the Cornwall iron furnace by Adam and Katerina Ort. And this particular house is from 1761, and it has a house blessing stone on it. Now, I was able to get a very bad old photographic image that had been enhanced and published at one point in time. I did essentially a digital rendering of it to produce what looks like a rubbing. And I have it up here on the screen so that folks will get a chance to see what this looks like. Oop, I'm skipping ahead. And it says, God bless this house and all those who go in and out. Glory to God alone and to no one else. In the German language, it says, Gott segen dieses Haus und alles, was da geht ein und aus. Gott allein die Ehre und sonst keinem anderen mehr. Adam and Katerina Orts. And then, of course, you'll see 1762 with the numbers spread out. And then the initials IMS, likely the name of the stonemason. Now, this is a really interesting thing. You can see a number of things to pay attention to here. Abbreviations, non-standard spellings, the use of ampersands that are somewhat sideways, that actually look like a U with a cross through it, because the word in German for and is und. And so you see the ampersand having that U shape as well. You can also see flourishes that are used to as placeholders. You see dots in between each word as a form of punctuation in between each word, not just at the end of sentences. And of course, you'll also notice if you look very carefully that the one for the date has a little loop to it. And many folks have taken this to mean im your. In the year of 1762. So the one is also a J, a stylized J. And there are many different ways of interpreting this, but that is one of the ways of looking at this unusual one character that especially is used for inscriptions on houses and carvings in stone. You even find this on gravestones as well. And speaking of gravestones, when I first saw this image, it reminded me of something. Now, I've been doing field work documenting houses, barns, graveyards for about 15 years in this area. And sometimes I have a little bit of a photographic memory. And I was able to recall a stone that reminded me of this one that was on the house. And lo and behold, it was for Adam and Katerina Orth. And it was a gravestone for their daughter, who died very young. And you'll notice, if you look very carefully, that the lettering is almost identical, and the individual's names correspond to the house. And so we can see, again, not only the crossover in terms of the trades, but also the content. You can see that the individuals who had their house built asked the very same stonemason who did the house blessing on their home to do the gravestone for their daughter who passed away prematurely. And you can see this lofty inscription again. I don't want to reiterate all the German language in these because it'll get very redundant after a while, but you can see the way in which it says, sie ist zum Heilen gegangen. She has gone to the Savior. You'll see many different ways in which the German language is used figuratively in these types of inscriptions, both on tombstones as well as on house blessings. And in the very same graveyard, now I don't believe this is the same carver, but we have two examples of two house blessing stones that were recycled. They were actually taken from the home of Peter and Barbara Kuker, who lived at Hebron, right near the location of the old Moravian cemetery. And when their house was torn down, for some reason, they recycled the stone from the home, they built an enclosure around the cemetery, and they recycled the date stones on the house and put them into the walls. Now, these are very enigmatic. On one hand, you see a beautiful heart, symbolizing, of course, love or dedication. You can see here 1761, again, that very stylized use of the one. You'll see M. Peter, so probably Michael Peter Kucher and Barbara Kucherin. Her last name has an I-N on it for a female suffix that is used throughout the German language in the 18th century to denote a person's name that has a female ending. So whenever you see an I-N at the end of a name, if it typically indicates a wife or a female individual. You'll notice as well that this stone on the home, and if you look to the right, you can see the locations of the stone on either side, the central window on the second floor on the facade of the home. You'll see that one of these stones has no inscription, but instead has this enigmatic image of a face that appears to be watching, the image of a rosette at the top of a column, which could, according to some people, be a tree of life overlooked by the sun or the moon or something astronomical. These types of images are very enigmatic, and we'll never truly know what the original interpretation of the stone carver would have been. But nevertheless, we can see this as being in keeping with this idea of blessing. And we're going to see a number of examples of things that we may not be able to explain. And it's really important for us to keep open minds about these things and not to develop theories that we can't substantiate and stick to those, but instead learn more about the region, learn more about what's out there, and gradually begin to make associations as we are able to explore more of these examples. I showed this stone already for Johann Jakob Losch in 1753. Again, you see a lot of similarity to some of the local tombstones with images of hearts and stars. Here's an example of a stone that's located right on the upper gable apex of this Germanic style house, as some people have referred to it, with a very steep roof, an asymmetrical layout to the fenestration and doors, unlike the last example of a home, which would have been Georgian, an English form of architecture. And this is an important thing to note, that we have two different cultures in this region that predominated architecture, English and German, and they were blended. And so many times you're going to find elements of both of those throughout. You'll notice as well that this particular stone is also using a Latin lettering. You'll also find some that uses German black letter fracture face as well. And so this is all important to note, as different features that add a sense of cultural texture to the area. One of the earliest examples of a house blessing stone that was documented by a minister by the name of P.C. Kroll, who lived in Wilmelsdorf. He documented date stones in the region, and one of the earliest he knew of was on a location in Lebanon County, not too far from Annville, called the Ulrich Homestead. This location had a lintel above the root cellar underneath the house that originally had this very morbid inscription from 1751, and it says, "As often as the door turneth upon the hinge, O mortal, consider thine end. And this kind of also rhymes. You'll see, so oft detoured an angle vent, O mensch, dein end bedenk. And you'll see that even the spelling of the German here is also, it's idiosyncratic because of it being part of a Pennsylvania culture that had variable spelling. Now, this particular inscription you see here is from a replacement stone. The house was modernized during the Victorian period, and that original stone was taken off of the root cellar and was incorporated into the stone structure of the porch. I've tried to track it down, and there's no trace of it at this point in time. But the inscription was replaced in a very formal sense over one of the windows of the house. So you can see the ways in which these stones are situated in a variety of different circumstances. This particular root cellar allegedly at one point in time was used as a stronghold. The occupants of the house hid in this particular root cellar during the French and Indian War to escape an attack. And so you see the way in which these types of morbid inscriptions oftentimes relate to the narratives of the local people and this sensitivity that life was short. And this is a very important thing to be aware of. Now, I spent a fair amount of time in Germany in the last couple years, strolling through the streets of places like Oppenheim in the Pfalz, documenting local inscriptions. And these are absolutely wonderful because these are the forerunners to what we see here in Pennsylvania. They really are. You can see examples of ones that are simply names and dates, and then others that are extremely detailed. The one on the upper left describes how the Rathaus, or kind of the administrative center in the town, burned down and then was rebuilt in 1719. You'll also find the one on the lower right says that basically that time will pass, that struggle will pass as well, but justice must persist. And this was on the courthouse. And so you can see lots of different types of inscriptions. Some of these are also very witty. At the very lower one, you see that one might wish what he will, but I would wish upon him 100 times. And so the idea of this witticism that is seen in these old stones as well in Germany is really fascinating. And here's a good example as well. This particular one says, work is the adornment of the citizens, blessing is the prize of toil. The sense of public appreciation for buildings by means of these house mottos is something that did come to Pennsylvania and inspired many of the inscriptions that you're going to see. Even though Pennsylvania, I would argue, is a little bit more formulaic and very exclusively pietist religious inscriptions, you do find occasionally some witticisms as well. I also want to point out too, here's an example, of course, the last example I shown from Oppenheim in the Pfalz, which is in the Rhine River Valley, precisely the same location where a lot of local folks can trace their roots. You'll find as well examples of the same types of stonework and cartouches that were done in a distinctly formal European Baroque style here in Pennsylvania, such as in Lititz, Pennsylvania. And here's one from 1784 that's on the Sturgis Pretzel Building, if you know the local area. And it says, built by Peter Kreider, and then it has an inscription of initials and date. And you can see the similarities here in these types of uses, these ornate Baroque cartouches. Another good example from Europe as well. This one says that it's really nice in this world that that neither God nor the devil can take money, and the poor must suffer without it while the rich go to hell. This is some really interesting religious ideas that are put right out in the public. And this was meant to be funny, but by today's standards, it would be very distasteful according to some. So it's really fascinating to see the way in which these European examples, and this was on a house barn combination that you can see to the left here, are very much the inspiration for what we find here in Pennsylvania. And oftentimes they fall into two camps, those that are considered to be protective and those that are inspirational. An example of one from Switzerland says, highest Lord above us, with your graceful hand, protect this house and storm from sickness, storms, and fires. It says as well, it's not in the fields and it's not in the trees, but it's in the heart that it must grow in order for one to become better. So the idea is that you're not only asking for divine protection, but divine inspiration. And these types of things turn up in Pennsylvania examples as well, these two particular themes, protection and inspiration. For example, in Lehigh County at the Troxel-Steckel House, built in 1756, the inscription reads, God protect this house from all danger and lead our souls into the halls of heaven. Clearly both a lofty inspirational inscription, but also one that tends to combine this aspect of both inspiration and also protection into the same inscription. Note the very stylistic German language inscription here with German lettering, not Latin lettering, as is often the case on many local examples. You'll see almost an identical inscription from the same local area, and this particular one is in Schnecksville, also in Lehigh County, and it says, God protect this house from all calamity and lead our souls into the heavenly abode. For Peter Romick and Hannah Romick. And it actually not only gives the year, but actually the full date of September 12th. And you can see that this is incorporated into very formalized federal architecture, which is also distinctly American, but has European, especially English influence to it. So you can see kind of this combining of cultures, a sharing of English architectural styles in early America with German language inscriptions that makes a very distinctive Pennsylvania flavor. You'll also find some that are distinctively what we might call Germanic. Here's an example of a Germanic style home that has an inscription by Hannes Hanwerk, and he was from the area just south of Blue Mountain in Lehigh County. It says, I, Johannes Hanwerk, built this house with the help of God in the year of our Lord, 1769. There's also this little number 30 at the top that's very cryptic, and we don't quite know what that means. So you're going to find a lot of situations where these stones pose questions, and over time we may discover the answers, but it's really important to document these and to be able to be aware of the questions so that we can find the answers as we look at more samples. Sometimes these inscriptions aren't outside of the home at all. Sometimes they're inside of the home, on lintels of doorways leading into basements, sometimes over lintels in the front door. But sometimes, like this particular example, we have a lintel that leads into a basement that may have been recycled from another part of the home. At the Yoder Homestead in the Yoli Valley, take close look at this inscription. It is very, very rough. And on one end of the lintel would have been the number 17. On the other side is 41. But the side of the lintel was hacked off as this particular lintel was recycled and put into a new circumstance in this home. And it says Johannes Yoder and his wife Anna Rosina in the year 1741. You see this word Hausfrau, Anna Rosina, being used. And you see many times these types of inscriptions especially named the husband and wife, which is very notably cultural. For the Pennsylvania Dutch, you're going to find some examples of this among the English as well, but especially among the German-speaking inhabitants of Pennsylvania, there seems to be this honoring of both husband and wife. Here are a couple German language shortcuts I want to share with you, because these are words you're going to encounter in a variety of different circumstances. The first being the word gebaut or erbauet, meaning to have been built. Sometimes ist gebaut worden means it was built by an individual, it's passive. Other times it was just simply a shortened passive, erbauet, or it's active, where it says so-and-so built this house. You'll also find im Jahr, which means in the year, or anno domini, which many of you are familiar with, in the year of our Lord. Again, you'll see Hausfrau or Ehefrau for the name of the wife of the household. You'll also see the feminine suffix and in at the end of a name. You'll see the name, you'll see the word Maurer or Maurerer being used to refer to the stonemason. And you'll also see Baumeister occasionally being used as well to refer to either a builder, but in the case of churches, a Baumeister would have been a person who was on the building committee, who was probably also serving as one of the people helping with the building process, but also a person who was essentially like a building trustee. So you see a variety of different circumstances where these words are being used. Now, just to give a couple examples of these husband and wife stones that you see, especially in the border region between Berks and Lehigh County, here are two examples from Kutztown. You see George Kemp and Susanna Kemp. They're using the anglicized form of Georg Kemp's name. Instead of Georg, it's George. You can see again this blending of languages and this blending of cultures from 1795. You also see three crosses between each of their names. Some people could look at these as placeholders. Other people could look at these as being a form of blessing. And it's really important to remember that the way that these stones were used was as a dedication of the building. And as folks dedicated the building, this was a formal process. Even if people didn't gather together for a formal ceremony, this was, in a sense, a social ritual of blessing the house. And sometimes this is religious, and sometimes this is secular, but many times you can see the blending of those two elements together. A great example of this is at the Hottenstein House just outside of Kutztown, often referred to as one of the most celebrated houses of the Georgian period in the Pennsylvania Dutch cultural region. And if you look at the top story of the house on either side of the front central window, you'll see these two stones for David Hottenstein and Katerina Hottenstein. And they use the word Anno Domini, which is spelled in an idiosyncratic way, 1783. This is part of formal Georgian architecture. And yet you'll see that it has some distinctive German flavors to it as well. You'll also see that Katerina Hottenstein's name was essentially shortened. Instead of Steinin, it just says Stein with an I-N. So it's an abbreviation using that feminine suffix. And so you'll see a lot of these types of elements. The common flat heart that is used on gravestones as well appears here in these formal cartouches that are echoed not only in the stones, but also in the keystones above the windows. So you can see a full integration here of these types of ideas into one particular structure. During this time, you'll also start to see this shift towards federal architecture, which becomes distinctly American, more ornate features used on the homes. And of course, also early Republic imagery that was borrowed from coinage and many other different circumstances where the federal symbol of the Republic was being used. And these are widespread throughout Berks County, Lehigh County, and then also Montgomery County. And you're gonna find some examples that look just like coinage of the period. And then you find others that are a little bit more stylized. One of my favorites in the lower right-hand corner, I don't have the translation written out. It says, it's for Valentine Stoll, who built his house in 1805. It's a very, very formal house right in Kutztown. And it says, Gottes Segen macht reich, which means God's blessing makes you rich. And you have to question, is this person saying that they are blessed because they are rich? Or are they saying that that God's blessing is enough for them? So there's some ambiguity in some of these things, and also perhaps a little bit of that kind of European cheekiness that you see coming through some of those examples that I showed in the Rhine River Valley as well. The cleverness, I should say, perhaps. And you'll see examples of this turning up in other forms of federal architecture as well. Formal examples of house inscriptions right over the front door, honoring the husband and wife. The one on the right was also up on the upper gable apex as a lunate house blessing plaque. And so again, you'll see many of these are not stones, but also examples of wooden plaques and wooden inscriptions as well. And these are in Berks County and Lehigh County. And again, you see the same types of iconography that overlap so many different aspects of life in the Pennsylvania Dutch country, especially the use of stars. There is no mistaking this. And you find especially stars on date stones, on house blessings, on examples of gravestones, oftentimes in this context of time, as though the stars themselves were symbols of time or the past of time. And this is so important to the spirituality of the Pennsylvania Dutch and thinking about the passage of time and the contents of a person's heart and what they are essentially doing with their lives. Another good example from the Milbach area is in Mill Creek Township, Lebanon County. Here are two really nice examples. This is a departure from the husband and wife formula that you see. Instead, it's a husband and wife, Johannes Bollmann and Anna Maria Bollmann. This is very, very idiosyncratic German language lettering, so it might be easy to mistake it for something else. You'll also see the name of the son, Jörg Bollmann, who was going to inherit the house, and the house was built in 1819. And these elements that you see here are classic examples of what you find in some fracture art and then also in gravestones in the Berks, Lebanon, Lancaster border, the Tri-County area. And so it's interesting to see that these may be the very same individuals who were also decorating furniture, who were going to be making fracture and carving tombstones as well. Now here's a nice Lebanon County example where you see not only the husband and wife, Johann Staver and Agnes Staver, but two different examples of inscriptions. One asking specifically for blessing, saying, Gott gesegne dieses Haus und wer da geht ein und aus. You see it rhymes. This is an inscription that specifically says, God bless this household and all those who are going in and out. And this specifically comes from from the book of Psalms, and you're going to find Psalm 121, verse 8. It says, God, watch over, you're going in and you're coming out. And you can see the way in which these are biblical verses that have been stylized over many, many years. The accompanying inscription here says, Free design in diesem Haus und mit denen welke Traus. Dieses Haus ist erbaut anno 1795. And it literally says, peace dwell in this house and with those who are outside of it. And this house was built in the year 1795. There's a lyricism to these that can't be overlooked. And I promise I won't read too much of the German language this evening. I've been doing my best to just provide the English, but the lyricism is such an important way of understanding how these examples were experienced within the community. There are some also that are extremely complex and sometimes laid out in ways that you have to wonder how hard it may have been for the average person to actually decipher what they meant. One here, these are in the same house, which is on the Berks and Lebanon border. It says, Wer Gott vertraut hat Volk gebaut in Himmel und auf Erden, wer sich verliest auf Jesum Christ, Jakob werden und Margareta werden. You can see that their last name actually ends up producing a rhyme with the rhyme scheme of the inscription. It says, he who trusts in God has built well in heaven and on earth. And whoever trusts in Christ, and it gives the names of the owners of the house. The next one says, God bless this house and those who go in and out. You can see again this very formulaic inscription, very similar to the very first one I showed, not too far from the Cornwall furnace. And it also says the same, to God alone the glory and none to anyone else, which again has a little bit of wit added in with it, from 1770. One of the most interesting examples that I've turned up in the Lebanon County area, however, is associated with a particular carver by the name of Henrik Revolt. Now, Henrik Revolt has been an ambiguous figure historically. I don't know much about him. The tax records are very scant. In some places, it looks as though he has no house, but he has a horse and about 6 shillings to his name, the only taxable goods that he would have had, which would have meant that maybe he was lodging with someone else, didn't have money, but was probably producing some pretty amazing stonework during that time. And these dates overlap quite a bit. So here's an example of the house that was built for Caspar and Sabina, spelled Savina, Schnabeli in Lebanon. Today, this is called the American House, and it is a social work house in Lebanon City. And this particular inscription that you can see has the very formulaic, God bless this house and all those who go in and out, gives the names of who the house was built for, and the year 1771, the opposite stone gives the name of the builder. And he has incorporated some form of angelic face that either was repaired at one point in time or is made of a different stone. It's very difficult to tell from the photography. It looks like it could either be very oxidized lead or maybe perhaps some piece of limestone or something that was lodged in there. It's very hard to tell, but it says, stonemason in Lebanon, Maurer in Lebanon, Heinrich Revolt, 1771. And then on the very bottom, you can make out 4 stonemason's tools. You can see on the lower left, the hammer and the plumb. The plumb is actually turned on its side, which may also be humorous because normally you use that right side up. It's not a level, it is a plumb. It has a shaped top and there would have been a little pendulum in there to be able to tell whether or not you have the surface plumb. And on the other side, you see a trowel and a square. And initially, I had wondered if these were Freemasonry symbols, but they're definitely stonemasonry symbols in this case because he was a builder. And I found his name also on the rolls for a nearby church, the Tabor Reformed Church, which is just a couple streets away in Lebanon City. And lo and behold, if you take a look at the stone that dedicates the church and then the stone of the Schnabelis, there is a lot of similarity with this in terms of the actual writing itself and the way it's put together. I believe that this was done by the same person. It was coinciding directly with the time that he would have been in Lebanon. This was 1792. And it says the cornerstone of this church was laid on June 26, 1792. Lord, keep watch over this house day and night and hear the prayers of the people. And then there's an inscription I can't quite make out. It says D-I-S-T-S-T-A-T-E-I-K-O and then chapter 8, verse 29. There is a biblical book being mentioned in here, and the Lord watch over this house and day comes from the book of Second Chronicles. So that could be accounting for the IKO, but the other part I can't interpret. So there's a lot of different portions of what you're going to see here where there's some cryptic elements that need to be paid attention to. And of course, there are many stones on this church. If you go there today, the stone in the front is the one in the lower right that says a High German Reformed Church, newly renovated in 1844. And they took all the old stones and they put them up above the windows on the, I think it's the west side of the building, which faces the street. And so a lot of them have these types of mottos. But many of the mottos don't actually correspond to the biblical verses that are listed. Like below, the do penance and believe in the gospel is not what Mark 1:15 says. So presumably these were not only something to be contemplated, but maybe it would actually encourage a person to look up that passage and then realize they're a little bit different. Maybe they were meant to be complementary passages. The book of Psalms, however, that is mentioned here is the actual verse. So this is all very interesting to me because you get to see the way in which these are part of a community interaction. They're not just static things sitting on a building. They're things that are meant to be read and reflected on and part of a community's identity as well. One of the most hilarious stones, and I guess I shouldn't call it hilarious, but I find it hilarious, is a stone that's on Haines Church in Wernersville, a Reformed church. It gives this lofty inscription that this is a High German Reformed church, which was built in the year of our Lord, 1766, and all those who go in and out should be obedient to God and King. Well, at some point in time, as the story goes, a very zealous congregation member, long after the revolution, this was often portrayed as though it happened during the fervor of the revolution, but this actually happened sometime mid-19th century. Someone went up with a chisel and they cut off the word king. And it's very likely that that person didn't read German because they actually obliterated the first syllable of the word to be obedient. So now it's an incomplete inscription. It no longer even says to be obedient to God because of the fact that they've obliterated that first syllable. So it's really fascinating to see the interaction with these things. They are not just static inscriptions. They are interacted with not only in terms of being read, but also something that occasionally gets amended or edited. And there's some social commentary in there that's really important. Occasionally, you're going to find out exactly who did the work on the church in the cases of church blessing stones. You're going to find many times names like the ones right here, examples of the building masters, the carpenter or shriner, the stonemason or maurer. You're also going to find abbreviations of names, little tradesman's marks as well, little images of leaves or tiny little stars or wheels. And these are classic examples of how tradesmen made little marks that were essentially kind of signature patterns. It is very likely that the person who did this work was Georg Fessler, who is buried in the church cemetery, and he's listed as the Maurer. If you see on the upper, out of the four stones, it's on the upper right. And this church is the Swamp Reformed Church in Reinholz. And the oldest Lutheran congregation in Pennsylvania, of course, if you take a look at the stone above the door of the Faulkner Swamp Lutheran Church, you get a chance to see that there is some, again, familiar iconography here, similar to what you are going to see on local barns, just like in my background here behind me. You're going to see this six-pointed rosette. And it's really important to recognize the kind of cross-pollination between so many different aspects of life and art. You're going to see the way in which these types of designs are being used on tombstones, on churches, on documents, on barns, on sentimental items kept in the home. They followed people through life. And again, the idea that these emblems are stars many times is relating to this notion of cosmological interest in time. And this explanation is one of the most satisfying that I've been able to find. Some people say they're just decorative. I will say certainly they are decorative and certainly they are beautiful, but there's content there as well. If we look very carefully at the attitudes of the culture and the way in which these types of designs were reflected upon many times, even sometimes overtly, in inscriptions in stone. And this is something that you're going to find again and again in the local region. And of course, these are the same designs you're going to find on local barns. And part of the reason I'm sharing this again is because there is a relationship between the designs you're going to find on the barns. Whether you find examples in Berks County that folks would have called Shtana or stars, or whether you're going to be referring to the ones in Lehigh, Montgomery, and Bucks that sometimes look a little bit more floral that some people historically refer to as Bluma in Pennsylvania Dutch, you're going to find some very, very similar designs, ones that are also sometimes used as maker's marks among stonemasons and other craftspeople as well. So you're going to see a cross-pollination here. And it's important to note that when the majority of the barns in Pennsylvania were first being decorated in the mid-19th century, it doesn't mean that there were earlier examples. We certainly know that the early 19th century, there was a lot. But by the 1840s especially, you start to see that the painted designs on the barns are actually being painted in combination with little cartouches that have the names and dates of the owners. And here's an example of one from Upper Milford, 1850. Some nice mid-19th century examples that correspond to the time when this barn was first painted, and the date and the stars on the barn are weathered enough to be able to tell that these were indeed the original designs on the barn from the time that it is indicated. And you can see the way in which these types of designs essentially migrated from original small stones, maybe subtle stones on the structures, to ones that became larger and more part of broader decorative schemes celebrating the agricultural architecture. And some of the earliest examples that we know of from the early 19th century and from the late 18th century on barns were date boards. So these are essentially the same as many of the local house and barn blessings that you're going to find that have images of the stars, initials of the husband and wife, and then also dates going along with them. Some of them are just dates and stars. Some of them are various permutations. Some of them have full names spelled out. But again, this is a parallel tradition to what we're going to be finding in terms of the inscriptions on local homes and churches. You'll also find these decorative traditions and inspirational traditions on barns as well. And sometimes you'll find inscriptions that have a lot of content as well. And I'll share some examples of those. But first, I want to point out the way in which these medallions, as they're referred in Georgian architecture, especially late 18th century and early 19th century, you're going to see the popular use of medallions on the upper gable apex of houses, especially those built in the English style. This particular type of medallion appears also on barns, and the way that it was used among the Pennsylvania Dutch is distinct from how it was used in other forms of Georgian architecture in other parts of the country. Medallions are popular. They were popular in Europe. They were popular in New England. But here in Pennsylvania, they seem to be inundated with the design work that is so distinctly Pennsylvanian, with these 8-pointed and 6-pointed and 16-pointed and 5-pointed stars and dates and initials. Upper example you've already seen in the very center on a barn, an upper gable apex of a barn from Greenwich Township, Berks County. Upwards to the right, you're going to see a Georgian farmhouse from the Ole Valley. On the upper left, you'll see a barn just outside of Kutztown that's just a design on the upper gable apex, no dates. The one directly below that on the lower left is from Montgomery County from the 1780s. If these are indeed the forebearers of the barn stars on the barns, these are some of the earliest examples of the tradition that we're going to be finding. You'll also find some lunate shapes as well on local barns with religious iconography. Take a look at not only the lilies and the little cross-like rosettes that are used throughout, but you'll also see an INRI in a very small little area at the bottom, bisected by a cross and the date 1823. INRI is an inscription that comes from biblical literature, Jesus Nazarenus Rex Iudaeorum, from the old Latin scriptures, and it says Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. And so this was oftentimes used as a blessing inscription. Even in informal ritual blessings that were done in the home, written on pieces of paper, used for healing occasionally, would use this inscription. And you find it also in these outward expressions on barns and houses as well sometimes. One of the last ones I have for you tonight is a really poetic example from the Sinking Spring area. You would be very disappointed if you go to the barn today. The medallion is literally falling apart. There's almost no plaster left, and the original painted lime plaster inscription is no longer there. You can't even really make out that it was there unless you know it was there. And a colleague of mine and I were able to find it. He spotted it from a distance while driving one day. We went there and we were thinking, wouldn't it be great to restore it? We still might ask the property owners if we can do that one day. The inscription says, Gott kann bauen und abbrechen, er kann geben und kann nehmen jedem nach es ihm gefällt. It literally says, God can build and he can destroy, he can give and he can take to each as it pleases him. And then it gives the name of the stonemason, Heinrich Ertz, stonemason. Mauer at the end, it says. And at the very top is SBM, perhaps the name of the owner or another builder, we don't know. But this is a beautiful example again. And you see this whirling flywheel at the top. Again, this idea of the passage of time being suggested by these types of astronomical images. Going one step further with the astronomical, here is an example of something you won't typically find on Pennsylvania structures. I know another one in historic Bethlehem with a religious inscription, but here's one in Richmond Township, Berks County, on a local barn. It says, Transit umbra manent opera. The shadow moves, but the works remain. This is an old Latin inscription that was used on sundials in Roman villas out in gardens in the middle courtyard, and it's from ancient times. And it literally is suggesting that although the shadow is going to move across the sundial and time is going to pass, the works of our hands are going to live after us. And to me, this is a perfect way to kind of sum up the way that we can think about these inscriptions, whether they be in German language or in Latin or in English on Pennsylvania structures. These are testaments to the lives of local people, what they valued, what they did with their time, what kind of legacy they were leaving behind for the rest of us. And there's an awareness of tradition in these types of inscriptions, the way in which we can see this awareness that folks were essentially communicating to future generations that something was being passed on, be it a kernel of wisdom, whether it be a religious inscription, something about the contents of the hearts, or simply the names of the makers. So we can see this as being at the intersection between secular and sacred culture, between the arts and architecture, and so many different aspects of life that are so very significant. That's all I have for you this evening. If you're interested in learning a little bit more about some of these traditions, you can find a copy of my book on hex signs, which also deals extensively with house blessing traditions as well. You can find this at the Heritage Center at Kutztown University, and it's also available on Amazon and other places like that. All proceeds from the sale of this book go to support cultural programming at Kutztown University. So.
Now ist die Zeit für unser Sprichwort von Monat, our proverb of the month. Lichtmess, spin vergess, halber Stroh und halber Fress. On Candlemas, forget spinning, half of the straw and half of the feed. As we move into the season of Lent, this little proverb pertains to the period of scarcity that follows Groundhog Day, as the earth has not yet woken from sleep. Nothing is growing and supplies on the farm begin to dwindle. It is small wonder then that the tradition holds this period as a time of restraint, reflection, frugality, and fasting. It was both spiritual and practical to conserve one's energy and supplies in the last throes of winter before spring arrives. As with all the old traditions, they express a relationship with the land that mirrors the human soul. While these beliefs are deeply rooted in the old liturgical calendar and embedded in the agricultural seasons, these ideas can still apply to us today as we transition to spring. In what ways can we prepare ourselves for a productive year ahead by taking stock of ourselves and our resources? What better way to take a moment for reflection prior to the rush that commences each spring? Take a moment for yourself. Be still and consider your immediate and long-term future. Vel lieve Guga, zelis alles was mir henheit für de Pensifonisch Deichstun. Gross dank für watche und mir komme bald zurück nächst Monat. Halt euch gesund und mach's gut.